everybody. It's nice to hear you, to be here. Today, the humanity finds itself at a turning point in history. With the start of the World War III, which began in February 2022, after the escalation of the war in Ukraine, the relative peaceful period of capitalist development has ended, and the era of open military struggle between imperialism and the anti-imperialist camps, countries, but also movements, has begun. The working class and the communist parties, as its vanguards, are the only forces who can use the given situation and turn the struggle against imperialism into socialist revolution. In order to succeed, the communists and the working class as a whole need to act as conscious historical subjects. They need to follow clear strategy and implement tactics based on the scientific analysis of the development and contradictions between imperialist and anti-imperialist forces, as well as within anti-imperialist camp itself. So the main, the first task here is to identify the contradictions within the imperialist camp, and that is in order to successfully define and implement the anti-imperialist strategy. We must first understand the imperialist camp in its contemporary form, as well as to analyze its essence and the driving forces that determine its historical development. It must be noted that the development of imperialist camp is not an isolated process, rather it has been interconnected with its opposite, the socialist and anti-imperialist countries and movements. The contemporary imperialism started to develop in its current shape after World War II. With the victory of early socialist countries over fascism and the subsequent socialist and anti-colonial revolutions affecting dozens of countries all over the world, the weakened imperialist countries and their dependencies regrouped under the undisputed hegemony of the United States. Unlike the period before World War I, where the contradiction existed between two imperialist alliances, or to World War II, where the struggle was fought between fascism and the USSR allied with liberal democratic imperialist countries like USA, United Kingdom and France, the historical development of both Cold War and the ongoing World War III is shaped by the struggle between imperialism and anti-imperialist camp. Following this logic, the World War I can be characterized as an inter-imperialist war, the World War II as anti-fascist, and the Cold War, and particularly World War III, as the anti-imperialist war. So after the temporary fall of early socialist states in Eastern Europe, it seemed that the victory and the subsequent hegemony of so-called Western imperialism is final. Some bourgeois ideologues, like Francis Fukuyama, even declared the end of history. At that time, during the 90s and the early 2000s, the imperialist camp, mostly throughout NATO interventions and the Colored Revolution, was able to suppress the majority of those who opposed its predatory politics. The examples of this being American invasion of Iraq in 2003, NATO intervention in Libya in 2011, NATO aggression on my country, Federal Republic of Yugoslavia in 1999, and the counter-revolution in my country in October 2000. Under the banner of so-called protection of human rights and democracy, imperialists and their allies killed thousands of peoples and destroyed once prosperous, self-reliant economies, and turning them into the perfect ground for extracting raw materials and also cheap labor force. However, the temporary victory of the imperialist camp was a period one, since it led to the further sharpening of the contradictions, which will ultimately lead to its demise. The first contradiction is that between the labor and the capital. Ever since the 1990s, the regimes in so-called Western democracies are becoming more and more reactionary. The temporary fall of socialism in Eastern Europe, as well as the subsequent deindustrialization of ex-socialist countries, led to the weakening of the labor movement. This in turn led to the gradual withdrawal of the rights of workers have gained in previous decades, the dissolution of so-called welfare states, as well as the destruction of democratic, so-called democratic institutions and processes that were once established by the liberal bourgeoisie itself. We currently find ourselves at the end of this process, therefore the young members of the working class are becoming more and more aware of the exploitative nature and inadequacy of capitalism. The so-called victory of capital over labor at the end leads to the increased revolutionary potential even in the countries of imperialist center. The second contradiction is the one between the countries of imperialist center and the dependent countries of periphery. The exploitation of majority of underdeveloped countries fuels the imperialist machine. Contrary to the dogmatic views of bourgeois ideologues and propagandists, the aim of imperialist system is not to erase, but maintain and further deepen the inequality between the first world and the third world nation. With the sharpening of the imperialist crisis, the economic but also political and military pressure put on the populations of dependent countries is increasing day by day. Since the big capital have already conquered all markets of ex-socialist countries, as well as because of the resistance of anti-imperialist nations, its space for further expansion is very limited. The imperialist desire to extract more and more super profits from dependent nations reveals its monstrous nature more openly and clearly, which leads to the rise of anti-colonial and national liberation movement across the imperialist periphery. With the success of anti-imperialist struggle in those countries, for example, Venezuela, Bolivia, most recent time Niger, the capitalist crisis further deepens. This in turn means the further loss of super profits that the bourgeoisie of imperialist center used to bribe its own working class and in order to assure peace at home. Having this in mind, it is clear that the anti-colonial struggle for independence also benefits the workers and the revolutionary movement in countries like United States, UK, France, or Germany. The third contradiction is the one between imperialism itself and the socialist, progressive, and anti-imperialist capitalist nations, which is collectively referred as anti-imperialist camp. This camp emerged after the victory over fascism and the subsequent socialist and anti-colonial revolutions around the world, which were supported by USSR and other socialist countries. Nowadays, it consists of early socialist countries like China, DPRK, Cuba, Vietnam, and Laos, progressive nations who conducted the or are currently waging the anti-imperialist and anti-colonial struggle like Venezuela, Syria, Belarus, Palestine, Bolivia, Nicaragua, and the capitalist countries whose bourgeoisie, due to the dissatisfaction with their current position, oppose hegemony of the Western imperialism. The ongoing World War III is actually the war between the imperialist and anti-imperialist camp. At this moment, the open battles are waged in Ukraine between capitalist Russia and NATO, as well as in Gaza between Israel, which is a US puppet, and the people of Gaza, supported by the countries like Iran and Syria. As the contradictions between imperialist and anti-imperialist camps are sharpening, there is an expectation that the new fronts will be open, primarily here in South Korea and in Taiwan, as well as in the Balkans region. It is worth mentioning that every victory of the anti-imperialist camp also benefits anti-imperialist movements in dependent countries. The example of Chinese initiatives in Africa show that this socialist country tends to reduce dependence from the West and in turn to develop necessary conditions for successful anti-colonial and socialist revolutions throughout the African continent. Similarly, the victory of Russia in Ukraine has the potential to improve the position of Eastern European countries, like my country, Serbia, by reducing their economic dependence on the West, but also to subvert military pressure imposed by NATO. For example, the victory of Russia in the Ukrainian war would be a step closer to the end of NATO occupation of southern province, Serbia, Kosovo, and Metohija. The leading role and the task. So, what's the leading role and the tasks of communists in the struggle against imperialism? It must be stressed that the aforementioned contradictions do not simply do not imply some kind of mechanical processes that are happening on their own, independent of even against the will of and action of real historical subjects. On the contrary, every battle, national or international level, highly depends on the so-called subjective factor. Although the developments analyzed above provide the framework of action, the outcome of every struggle can vary between the victory and the defeat of anti-imperialist forces. In order to conduct the effective struggle and to destroy the might of imperialism as soon as possible, we must examine the aforementioned subjects and define tactical approach to each of them. So in the struggle against imperialism, especially in World War III, there are several classes whose interests, at least at the current moment, are aligned with the weakening or complete destruction of the imperialist camp. As communists, it is our task to understand the interests of different classes and, according to this analysis, define our tactical approach. Since we are forced to create alliances, even temporary ones, we must foresee which allies and under which conditions will change their side and eventually align themselves with their former enemies, being the imperialists. Firstly, there are capitalist classes of anti-imperialist countries. The bourgeoisie of these countries were able to, on a national level, create monopolies relatively independent from those of the imperialist camp. Their success is the result of the specific conditions in their countries, as well as the fact that capitalism, besides concentration of capital, also tends to create new monopolies in relatively young industries. The example of bourgeoisie in Russia shows that in some cases their independent position is also the result of the formation's economic and military infrastructure established during the socialist period. The main interest of this type of bourgeoisie is not to the complete destruction of imperialism, let alone the socialist revolution in the countries. The main reason why they oppose the imperialist camp is that they are not satisfied with their position within it. They would be willing to support imperialism, but not under current unfavorable conditions for them. They have no interest into bringing the fight to an end. Rather, they are willing to make concessions halfway through. Therefore, the communists need to pay special attention when allying with these forces, and their task is to force them to conduct the struggle as far as the conditions allow, and to foresee their eventual betrayal in order to isolate them from the movement and ensure their defeat as well. The second subject that has a prominent role in the struggle either for or against imperialism are the wide stratum of petit bourgeoisie. This class is mostly disorganized and usually serves as a reserve to either national bourgeoisie, imperialist or not, or the working class. On the other hand, since they cannot hope for a more privileged position under the imperialist system. We have these petite bourgeoisie elements. Generally, the interests align with the proletariat, but a lot of times they can be tricked by the imperialist bourgeoisie into supporting reactionary, even fascist regimes. And the third factor is the proletariat itself, which has the main interest in the defeat of imperialism, and which is only capable to lead the struggle to its end. And the final goal is not just destruction of imperialism, but also socialist revolution. So, in this perspective, we as the working class and we as the vanguard of the working class must force other forces and other subjects to the end, and the end is socialist revolution itself. And so, in conclusions, the battles of World War III still lie ahead of us, and the struggle against imperialism is currently waged on the battlefields, but it is also waged on theoretical domain against bourgeois theory and propaganda, as well as opportunistic elements inside our movement. Both of these struggles, theoretical and practical one, are not easy. We are aware, though, that our only option is struggle and victory against imperialism criminals. If if we give up the fight, we are giving up our future and even our lives. In order to gather, organize and properly direct the anti-imperialist forces, the World Anti-Imperialist Platform is formed. During a year and a half of its existence, it proved itself as one of the few initiatives that has real potential to threaten the hegemony of the United States, as well as to develop theoretical bases that can answer the needs of contemporary movement. But we, the communist and anti-imperialist forces, must continue to organize ourselves, to coordinate our struggle, and to further engage in theoretical, scientific discussion, which is based not on the wish to describe the world, but on the need to make real and practical changes, the ones that will lead to the victory against imperialism, as well as capitalism itself. Thank you.